Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Welcome to Good Shepherd Greer on a bright sunny morning as we're recording. Not quite sure what the weather will be like tomorrow. I understand it's going to pour with rain. At least it's not snow. This morning's service will proceed as usual with Father Mark bringing you communion in your pews. Please maintain distances and keep your masks on, except if you're coming up here to read. We will be having our annual meeting, and we've had a good response to online voting, so looks like that will have worked. And by the end of the day, we will have a new vestry, so we will pray for their work and that all goes well for them, and also praying for a new rector. We're very grateful to Father Mark that he has agreed to be with us as many Sundays as we need him so that we have consistency. But it would be nice to have knowledge of what happens next, and that we don't have, so all we can do is pray. I don't believe there's anything different, so we'll continue with our service.
Good morning.
Good morning.
For those of you who are joining us via the internet, our service of Holy Eucharist Rite 2 begins on page 355, and I'm not always able to remember to give you the page numbers. Those of you who are here in person, you have programs all printed out, so you don't need the page numbers, but I'll try to remind you during this service of where we are in the Book of Common Prayer for those of you worshiping at home through the internet. We begin, as I said, on page 355. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Give us grace, O Lord, to answer readily the call of our Savior Jesus Christ and proclaim to all people the good news of His salvation, that we and the whole world may perceive the glory of His marvelous works, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. And now let us be seated for one of the most important parts of our worship, and that is the reading of the lessons.
The first lesson is from the prophet Jonah, chapter 3. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, the great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk. And he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today is a portion of Psalm 62, found on your insert, or in the Book of Common Prayer on page 669. Let us read together verses 6 through 14 of Psalm 62. For God alone my soul in silence waits, truly my hope is in him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my stronghold, so that I shall not be shaken. In God is my safety and my honor. God is my strong rock and my refuge. Put your trust in him, O Israel's people. Pour out your hearts before him, for God is our refuge. Those of high degree are of a fleeting breath. Even those of low estate cannot be trusted. On the scales they are lighter than a breath. All of them together. Put no trust in extortion. In robbery take no empty pride. Though wealth increase, set not your heart upon it. God has spoken once, twice have I heard it. That power belongs to God. Steadfast love is yours, O Lord, for you repay everyone according to his deeds.
A reading from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. I mean, brothers and sisters, the appointed time has grown short. From now on, let even those who have wives be as though they had none, and those who mourn as though they were not mourning, and those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing, and those who buy as though they had no possessions, and those who deal with the world as though they had no dealings with it. For the present form of the world is passing away. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat, mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of each of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. In this morning's gospel reading that you just heard, Jesus bid Simon and Andrew, and then brothers James and John, to follow me, let's go fish for people. And they responded by immediately setting aside their fishing nets and followed the Messiah. In very practical, non-spiritual terms, their abrupt departure from their workplace seems to be little more than irresponsible behavior. They just walked away from the family business to follow some itinerant backwoods preacher. But we really don't know all that was going on in their lives or even in their encounter with Christ. The Gospels are not intended to be a biography-type book that covers all the details, so we don't know what all was going on. But whatever had happened, it is clear that their hasty departure really was both a personal response to meeting the charismatic Messiah and then their ensuing relationships with him that followed. That and a spiritual response to God the Father, to God our Creator. Jesus was beginning to build his kingdom here on earth. He was recruiting his followers. He was, pardon the expression, evangelizing. Now, it's no secret that we Episcopalians, that is, we who are God's frozen people, are generally not known for our rabid evangelism. Johnny Carson used to have a thing, a comedy sketch, which he would say, words you're never going to hear. Well, you're never going to hear anyone in Greer say to their wife, "Honey, whatever you do, if the doorbell rings, don't answer it. Those Episcopalians are back in the neighborhood going door to door again." Jehovah's Witness, maybe, but Episcopalians don't do that. In fact, we struggle with evangelism, and perhaps the evangelism seems so difficult for us to grasp and to really like, because as with stewardship, evangelism can become little more than just a mandatory task that, well, somebody's got to do it, rather than a natural, to-be-desired fallout from a loving relationship with Christ. St. Francis is credited with saying, "It is no use walking anywhere to preach unless our walking is our sermon." Each and every one of us is a preacher in evangelism. And our loving relationship with Christ is our sermon. It also ought to be our evangelism. It's just that simple. It ought to be both a loving response to Christ and a loving response response to our neighbors and even a loving response to ourselves, all of which is facilitated not by us. We don't go out and save people. God saves people. All of this loving relationship is facilitated by the Holy Spirit. I think there's perhaps another reason, too, that we Episcopalians are so turned off by the E word. Maybe, just maybe, we witness so much evangelism done poorly that we've come to think that all evangelism is odious. We all know we don't love our neighbors by telling them that they're going to go to hell unless they think exactly like we think, and to be sure, we think exactly like the preacher thinks or the bishop. We're Episcopalians. We hopefully think for ourselves. We don't introduce the Prince of Peace by declaring war upon sinners, especially as we all claim to be sinners. We don't introduce the concept of eternal life by scaring people to death with death. All of that judgmental stuff is the exclusive purview of the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit can do all of that with a lot more love than we can. We do our part, but we leave the heavy lifting to the Holy Spirit when it comes to evangelism. I'm intrigued with Christ's approach to evangelism in this morning's gospel passage. His simple words were, "Follow me." For far too many years, the church has tried to improve upon that simple formula, that simple approach, with some grand-scale, structured, formalized evangelical programs, which have almost all failed miserably. Let's keep it simple. Let's keep it sincere. Let's keep it unpretentious. Follow me. Follow me to the Church of the Good Shepherd. Get your cat and its travel container and follow me down to the church to the blessing of the pets. Follow me to my grandbaby's baptism. We want neighbors and friends there. Follow me to the neighborhood house blessing. Follow me to the renewal of our wedding vows. I mean, it's only been 50 years, and now we're going to stand up in front of the congregation and renew our wedding vows, and we would love to have our friends, including you, present there for us. So follow us to the church. You want to go to church this Sunday morning? We can do lunch afterwards. That's evangelism. That's Episcopal evangelism. And it just doesn't get any better than that. We're willing to give some time and some friendship to some friends, some people, even family. You get your friends and your neighbors and your families involved here in church to some extent, even if it's a visit. However slight that involvement is, and then we will let the Holy Spirit do the heavy lifting. Our evangelism is our heartfelt worship of Christ. Our evangelism is also our welcome to and inclusion of others. I'm convinced there's nothing more comfortable for a believer than a small, very friendly church. And it's well within our power to comfort ourselves all the way to becoming the smallest congregation in Greer if we choose. But I think God has bigger things in mind for Church of the Good Shepherd. In reality, there's no such thing as a true status quo church. Parishes either are growing or they're sinking in attendance and finances. This factor, coupled with the current pandemic restrictions and the very active ongoing search for a new permanent rector, all afford the temptation for us to just simply sit back and wait for factors that are largely beyond our control. If wait we must, then wait we will, but there are important steps that we can be taking even while we're waiting. This is not to imply that a lot of work has not already been done in these areas, but we need to continue. We need to take the time and opportunity to express our appreciation to those who have worked so hard during these past few months, and then we need to move on from there. Our gospel reading reminds us much remains to be done, especially in our ongoing efforts at parish growth, in other words, evangelism. We need to pray, project, and plan, even as we are waiting. We are a people of prayer with a prayer book. A lot of prayers have been said around here, and even more need to be said. I think we ought to be specifically praying for membership, financial, and spiritual growth, increasing our numbers and our ability to do outreach here at Church of the Good Shepherd. We need to accurately project who we are and where we are following these months of restrictions. Have we lost some people in the process? Are we sure we know that we haven't? I suspect that, like James and John, we have some net mending to do before we go fishing with the Messiah. And finally, we need to be planning our evangelistic efforts so that we are ready to go when the restrictions are lifted. We ought not build yet another grand evangelistic program destined to eventually fade into the woodwork. We don't need to do a program. We want the new rector, when he or she arrives, to be a big part of that. That's going to be necessary for it to subsist and to continue. Rather, in the meantime, as we wait, we should enter into a dialogue one with another to at least share a common vision of what will and what won't work with evangelism at Church of the Good Shepherd. The decisions are yours to make. And evangelism is going to take on a certain stance in the immediate time following the restrictions. I think that's going to be a very crucial time. We will mend our nets, repair what we've lost, and then try to grow in the name of the Lord. And having said that, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, let us say together, stand and say together the Nicene Creed to affirm our faith in this parish, but more especially in our Lord. Together we believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, the eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and in the kingdom of heaven will end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge our baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
And now we will move to the prayers of the people.
Prayers of the People, Form 6, is found on page 392 of the Book of Common Prayer and also in the bulletin with the parish prayer list. In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, and Andrew, our bishop. For Mark, our priest today, and for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in his church.
Let us pray together for the members of our vestry and search committee and the clergy who are in a discernment process. Almighty God, look graciously on the people of Good Shepherd. Be with us and lead us as we seek the next rector for our church. We ask your direction and guidance for those who will choose our new spiritual leader, who will care for your people and equip us for our ministries. Grant us perception, faithfulness, and joy, so that we may hear your voice in all our deliberations. Grant us also the desire and the ability to truly hear each other and those who have entrusted us with this process. Give us courage to respond and act as you lead us. Come, Holy Spirit. We pray for other special needs and the concerns of this congregation, considering especially those on our parish prayer list found in your bulletin. In the diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for the people and clergy of Grace Church, Anderson. In our parish cycle of prayer, we pray for Heather Smith, John, Stacy, and Madeline Stewart, Jessica Sullivan, Michael Thomas and Patrick DeCrane, Loretta and Ron Tingle, Bill and Kay Toms, B.J. Tucker, Richard Pagano and Barbara Verderisi, Jim and Tony Wagner, Barbara Wilson, Brian, Lynn, and Mark Wiest, and for Jonathan Parker. We also pray for Donna, Davis and McMahon, Jim, Lee, and for Jim Davis. For Patty, Phyllis, and Pat Howard. For Mish, Paula, John, Betty, Carolyn, Norma and Freddie, and for Scott Ash. For Robert, Ashley, Alfie, Amanda, Mary, Sam, Richard, Mara, and for Patty Herman. For Melanie, John, Steve, Jamaica, Sharon, Bill, Luke, and Elena. For Richard, Sarah, Tim, Ed, Arlen, and Cindy. For Houston and Julie, Lisa and Reese, and all those suffering from or recovering from COVID. We pray for family and friends who are nurses and pharmacists working on the front lines during the pandemic. Lisa Jacob, Cara Wallace, Anna Carlton, Christine Irving, and Jessica Denzin. We pray for the vestry members and the nominees that they may feel the support of God and this community. We pray for all chaplains, medical and ancillary staff, especially those working in vaccination centres, therapists, and others who are putting their own health at risk to minister to the needs of the sick, and for all the unsung heroes helping those in need during this time of crisis. We pray for all children throughout the world who are separated from their families for whatever reason. We pray for the people and clergy of our sister church, All Saints, Downhackney, Gloucestershire, England. Pray for all the men and women of our armed forces and first responders, along with their families and friends, wherever they may be serving, remembering especially Micah Anderson, Alyssa Drexler, Daniel Gottridge, Avery Groves, Annabelle Groves, Zachary Garek, Shannon Heiberger, Allison Hoffman, Robbie Lark, Jamie McLaughlin-Lepak, Jessica McLaughlin-Lepak, John Miles, Matthew Moran, Ryan Campy, Dylan Schroeder, Jason Schroeder, James Soles, Jessica Sullivan, and Eddie Cutshaw. For peace in the world, thy kingdom come. Hear us, Lord, for your mercy is great. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King,
and praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them
who put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Greet one another in the name of the Lord. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. All things come of thee, O Lord,
and of thine alone have we given thee.
We'll be using Eucharistic Prayer A, and that's found on page 361 in the Book of Common Prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father, Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, for by water and the Holy Spirit you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Blessed in the highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, send Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and parent of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. We offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All of this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Hallelujah, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us eat the feast. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us out into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you. With gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and go with you always. Amen.